This disk here is copy protected, meaning it's designed in a way to be difficult, if not impossible, to copy.
There were at least a dozen different methods of copy protection that were used back in the day, and I'm not going to go into how each and every one of those worked, but needless to say, there were a lot of people who were very motivated to defeat that protection, and one of the ways that you could do that was by cracking the software.
So imagine this is a timeline showing the game load starting right here, and after a minute or two, you end up at the intro screen of the game. Now clearly, somewhere in this section of the loading process will be some copy protection code, something designed to detect if the disk is authentic, and if it isn't, then loading will fail. Now a traditional software cracker would go in and look at the code and attempt to identify this section, and then remove it or disable it so that even copies of the game would load with no problem, but this required somebody with a lot of programming skills to accomplish. But what if you could just take a snapshot of the computer's entire RAM right here at this moment? Well, enter the ISEPIC cartridge, which came out in 1985. I used to download games from BBSs back in the day, and I would see this ISEPIC logo on the screen, and I thought it was the name of a cracking group. Little did I realize it was a result of this ingenious cartridge. Now, there were many snapshot cartridges that were released over the years, such as this one, such as the Super Snapshot, but as far as I'm aware, the ISEPIC was the first of its kind. With this cartridge, I also have the original user's manual, although in a bit of rough shape, and the original software disk, which is critical to its operation. This 1985 issue of Ahoy magazine discusses the ramifications of the cartridge, where they point out that this treatment will bypass any disk copy protection schemes which have been used by the original software boot routines. So, how does it work exactly? Looking at the PCB itself, its main component is this chip here, which is just a 2KB SRAM chip. The rest of these chips are just glue logic, so how does adding 2KB of RAM to the C64 make this possible? Well, the switch is part of it. The switch allows the RAM to be hidden, or turned off so to speak, that way it's totally undetectable in that state. It also allows code to be stored on this chip that isn't part of the usual memory map. I mean, think about it for a moment. If you wanted to write a 2K program to override and copy the rest of RAM, where exactly would you put it in the C64 memory map? Almost any game or software you load is likely to wind up overwriting the code, since this machine was never designed to run more than one piece of software at a time. So the answer is, put it in a cartridge. This is sort of like the InfoSphere scanning itself, and the ISEPIC cartridge is analogous to the scanner. So let's take a look at the ISEPIC cartridge in action. I have a period correct C64 set up here. I apologize, the disk drive is not period correct as I don't have any working gray 1541s right now. But I'll start by inserting the ISEPIC into my Commodore 64. Now, the cartridge by itself doesn't really do anything, so I have to also insert the ISEPIC software disk into the drive and load that up. Now once I get to the menu, I'm going to need to prepare a disk. So I'll grab a blank disk here and I'll just put a temporary label on it with a masking tape. And next I'll use the DOS command option to format the disk. This takes about a minute to complete. And then I can move on to preparing the disk by pressing P. Now I already have the disk in there, so I'll just press space. Now once that's done, it returns the menu and then I can select Copy Program. Now at this point, it asks me to flip the switch on the cartridge. Now during this brief pause, it's actually copying the necessary code over to the RAM chip in the cartridge, after which it will reboot to basic like normal. So what I'll do now is insert the game I want to copy, in this case, Ghostbusters. I would imagine you could also load in a cassette-based game here at this stage just as easily, and it wouldn't matter. Ghostbusters takes a few minutes to load, and during this process, if I had a regular 1541 drive, it would be headbanging about now as it goes through its copy protection routine, but eventually the game starts up. Ghostbusters! And what I'll do now is flick the switch, at which point I'm instructed to turn the drive off and back on, and then insert the storage disk, so I'll do that. And then I have to flick the switch again, and then one more time, flip it back. At this point, you don't get a lot of feedback as the screen just stays blue and the drive is running. At this point, it is saving the contents of RAM to the disk. Now, once it's done, it'll return to this menu, and I'm going to list the directory, and you can see that it has created a bunch of different files. So what are these? Well, the first four PGM files are 16K chunks, which together form the entire 64K of RAM for the system. The PGMC is the color RAM, and the PGMX is the processor status registers. So all of these files together are enough to store the complete state of the computer at any given time. In fact, I could press R to run the game, and it would load these files, and then I could resume what I was doing in Ghostbusters as if it had never stopped. Now, this would be handy if I were playing a game, for example, one that doesn't have any sort of game save feature like Donkey Kong. And let's say I'd made it really far into the game, and I wanted to save my position so I could start up the game tomorrow from the same spot I left off. Now, this adds both convenience and, to some degree, cheating, because if I die in the game, I can always start back at this saved spot. Now, to run the game in this current state, you do need the ISEPIC software and cartridge. But another option here in the menu is to break the game, and if I choose that option, it'll go to work for several minutes. And when it's done, it'll ask for a name. I'll type in Ghostbusters, and then you can see in the directory it has made two new files called Ghostbusters. These two files are all you need to load and run the game from now on. They aren't copy protected, so they're easy to copy to another disk or upload to a BBS or whatever. In fact, one nice thing about loading the game like this is that it actually loads faster than usual, even without the use of a fastloader cartridge, and it's because it isn't doing that copy protection stuff. Which is also nice because there will be no headbanging either. But did you notice that when the game started, it didn't say Ghostbusters? Do you know why? Well, let's look at the clip where I flicked the switch. As you can see, I flicked it after the intro speech had occurred, so my cracked version starts exactly where that left off, because the code believes that it already did that.
So what you'd probably want to do is use like a stopwatch to determine exactly how long the load process is. That way you can flick the switch right when the loading is done, but not quite when the intro had started. But anyway, you get the idea of how this would work. Now, one thing that should be pointed out is that obviously this isn't going to work with every single game. It's certainly not going to work with multi-disc games or any sort of game that requires accessing the disc drive after the game has already been loaded. This is going to work mostly with what you would call single load games, where the entire game is loaded into RAM and then the storage device is never touched again after that point.
Anyway, I hope you enjoyed looking at this little forgotten piece of history. I downloaded many games from BBSs back in the day that showed this ISEPIC logo during load. And anyway, that's all for now. So as always, thanks for watching.